Mini Chapter 80, Jaymi test drives the Platinum Raven. Early the following evening, Jaymi's forehead bumps into his laptop screen. He jolts alert, sits up and stares around. Across the hillside, tall dark fingers stand in rows, swaying back and forth as in a drug-induced painting, as if to beckon him. Those Italian cypresses. He must be back at the house on Zeus Drive. Yes, of course he is. He returned here this afternoon from Electra Drive, because although he did manage to create the Platinum Raven soundtrack and see it come alive up there, he awoke today with a vivid sense that she needs to complete her creation cycle in the place where it began, here on this terrace with its swimming pool colonnade, its lower sun deck, and its Italian cypresses waving at him like fingers. He shakes his head to wake himself, he's operating on a sleep deficit, he reminds himself, and returns his attention to her. Her desert eyes are in close-up again, filling the screen, as they did before the zoom-out from her dam and the zoom back in to her concert. This time, however, she is facing not at him but over his left shoulder. He glances around to identify what she's looking at, but it's just a view across the terrace towards the swimming pool colonnade. He looks back at her, and this time she's facing resolutely over his right shoulder instead. He shoots a glance in that direction too, but there is nothing much there either except the end of the terrace where birds of paradise flowers fleck a dark bank of foliage with sap-dripping plumages of orange. "Do bend that lambent alien flame-like attention in this direction, would you?" he asks her aloud. She complies with the faintest flash of irony. "Okay, babes, now, before we let you loose in LA, we're going to test you," he says. "You are, after all, the richest communication I could have with the world, from this position of peculiar isolation within it. We therefore need to equip you as best we can. So let's give you a little backstory, in the form of memories of another city, as depicted on that postcard you're holding. And rather to her surprise, there in the photo on the postcard is herself. She's leaning at a metal balcony railing above the lower tip of Manhattan, looking down on it from 2 or 3 miles height, with the calm of a winking satellite on a cool summer evening, but welling up with enormous love for the familiar form of this unique and electrically powerful little island. It's long and thin, yet hard as nails and concrete, its lower west side and furthest lower east side bristling with piers, which tells her she's looking at its past, not at its present. The East Village spreads out sunlit beneath her left elbow. The 59th Street Bridge soars over the slim line of Roosevelt Island as if the latter is a ship gliding down the East River beneath the bridge's span. Hunt's Point is at the top of the image, dim and flat, with Rikers Island and the Brother Islands just beneath it. Her dark dress billows behind her, perhaps in a slight breeze on the balcony, in echo of the flow of her hair down the back of her white t-shirt. This being a monochrome image, she cannot tell what colours her actual dress and hair were. She flips the postcard over. "Copyright David Lombard, Girl at Railing, Reproduction Prohibited," says the caption of her image, which she has to uncover by peeling off a black self-adhesive sticker she'd affixed to the card in some intervening year. "Remember?" Jaymi asks her, "'cause I sure remember. I had that on my wall, beside my desk, throughout the time I lived in New York." Pink noise whirs through his laptop speakers. "Okay, cut to later in your early life in New York City," he continues, "and the monochrome has deepened into colour. But the colours of the night, of course. And now she's looking sideways, across the matchless allure of the Manhattan cityscape after sunset, from just above the skyscraper's tops. The 3 or 4 most iconic structures are all where they should be, as if her framing them like this were easy, and there's a subtle perfection of lighting. Above the myriad illuminated windows, in buildings whose shapes will remain discernible for only another 30 minutes in this sinking dusk, there's a soft-edged band of orange, merging flawlessly into yellow right above it, merging further through nameless subtleties into pink, at last hitting the upper frame as a cool, dim lilac. All these being darker and tinged with russet at the left end of the image. Here, 30 floors above 53rd and Lexington, she turns to the left where the east grows dimmer, taking in the expanse of Queens and Brooklyn in the dusk. Above the soft flicker of the very furthest beds of lights, an aeroplane hangs still, sinks through a brown glow down into purple, and disappears behind the dark horizon. A charcoal layer presses down, far beneath high clouds, underlit from low sun setting in the west behind her head. One lone skyscraper stands on the East River's other bank, across from her, topped by scarlet beacons like a pair of mineral eyes. From his lips to his fingers, Jaymi sends the lightest kiss, then lays it upon the screen at a point beneath her feet. "And then you went to Hollywood, remember?" he tells her. "You drove to this city from the east all alone, and on the edges of this city, all alone, you parked the car upon a bridge at night and stared down onto the freeway beneath. And you held up your camera and snapped the shot you're holding, which was printed in reverse a year later. Remember? 'Cause I sure do." She gazes at the print in her hands and remembers. In the lanes on the right half, headlights have made electric streams, while a slow camera shutter opened wide, being fused into white molten strings, since frozen into dry ink. While on the left, a lonely pair of red molten rear light strings might suggest that this image of a moment in her past had been snapped in a country that drives on the left, had the image not been printed in reverse many years later. And boom! "You are ready for your incarnation," he tells her, "in all your luscious platinum transcendence. What do you say to that?" His laptop speakers purr pink noise louder than before. He turns the screen around to face LA for a moment, to show this beast a flash of where she'll soon be released. As if on cue, fiery puffballs burst in the sky, a firework display somewhere down in Laurel Canyon. The embers of the puffballs twinkle in the silence as they fall across the hills. Chemical sunset, dancing city, darkness in the canyons.